morning sun shines on the gleaming hide of a muscular ranch horse. The aroma of bacon and coffee drifts from the wood cook stove at a cow camp. Silver spurs jingle as the men and women of the West get set for another day in the saddle. From the heart of Canada's finest ranching country, this is the Spirit of the West with rancher and horse trainer Hugh McLennan and his collection of music, poetry, and conversations with the folks who live and work with horses and cattle in the Spirit of the West.
Well, most of the calves are proudly wearing the new brands and their ear tags, and as the pastures and ranges are greening up, those calves are really starting to grow. And as much as ranchers love being horseback at spring turnout, the paperwork, it seems, never ends. But the more you know, the more you can make, I think. And this week, that numbers crunching ag expert and rancher Ernie Isrealson continues to talk about rates of gain, cost per cow, cost per bull, and much more with our support team, Mark and Kathy McMillan.
And I've hauled enough calves in the barn to warm them up.
Yeah.
So we're on the other side of the equinox now. We're more like first part of April.
And on the rangeland news this week, well, what do you know?
However, food shoppers could get a break this year.
And the cowboy poetry spotlight shines on a ranch way down south.
Now, life as a cowboy here was very, very tough. Surviving the elements from year to year in a land that was wild and woolly and rough.
On the Irvine Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File, we'll look at the big danger lurking when horses are turned out on those lush green spring pastures. It'll be a quick course on laminitis and founder, and they are not the same thing. Ernie Isrealson analyzed the pitfalls of spending big bucks on bulls after that ranch-raised kid from Flat Lake, Alberta gets us out the gate.
Generation on the same piece of land. My grandfather's grandfather paid just $10 to a government man for this little piece of heaven that I will always call home, and that won't ever change. It runs right through my veins, straight to my soul. Well, you can put me in the city, and I'll do just fine. But give me my saddle and a good horse to ride. 'Cause at the end of the day, when the work's all done, I wanna hang my hat knowing where I come from. I've got country in my blood. From up on the stage, but nothing compares to what I got right here in this wide open space. Yeah, you can put me in the city, and I'll do just fine. But give me my cattle and a tractor to drive. 'Cause at the end of the day, just fine. But give me my saddle and a good horse to ride. 'Cause at the end of the day, when the work's all done, I wanna hang my hat knowing where I come from. I've got country in my blood. I've got this country in my blood. Country in my blood. I got this country in my blood.
Well, for the last couple of weeks, analyst, rancher, agriculturist Ernie Isrealson has opened a lot of eyes with his savvy insight into the cattle industry as he visited with Mark and Kathy.
You know, one day I was sitting in my office and you go to a bull sale and I can be kind of cheap all right. I just try to buy in the lower range, but, you know, some people get to really want a bull and, you know, instead of a $4,000 or $5,000 bull, they end up with a $10,000 yeah. bull, eh? And so I thought, well, I wonder how that checks out. So I took a sheet of paper and I put the, on the top side, I think I started at $4,000, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. And then on the other index, I put, if we had, you can use it for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 years, eh?
Right.
Because over the time, the bulls should get a little cheaper. And just as basic an example, and then the other thing you have to figure out what it costs you to keep a bull every year, eh? In the summertime, they're on pasture, so it's not much different than a cow and a calf as far as a grazing fee.
Yeah.
But in the wintertime, you put them in a separate location, and they're going to cost more. Like this winter, with the price of hay, it might be $5 a day. Mm-hmm. They're not going to be cheap, eh? And then come spring, you got to add in semen testing them, and maybe a hoof trim once in a while, and whatever else. So you figure all those costs out, and they're basically the same for every year, so it's not too hard to fill in each blank with what it costs
right,
per year.
Right, I see what you're doing.
Yeah. And then at the end, you've got a salvage price for the bull,
yeah,
which could be $2,000 or higher like this last summer, eh? So just an example, say if you bought a bull, and he cost you, let's say, $6,000, and you got to use him for that year, but he crippled up and you had to sell him that fall. Right? Mm-hmm. It was a short enough term, eh? And so maybe you have $500 worth of feed costs in because you bought him in March and had to get him to breeding season and stuff like that, eh? So you got $6,500 in this bull, and you get $2,000 out of him. So there's a dead weight there, $4,500,
yeah.
Eh? And if that bull bred 30 cows, which, you know, is kind of average, 25 to 30, you divide that into the $4,500, and that's $150 per cow that mm-hmm. when she has that calf next spring, you should put that charge against that calf before you start figuring out what's
going to happen. Figuring out
your
cost, yeah.
And if you really want to get shocked, well, go to the $10,000 bull, you know. And on average, we get about 3 years out of our bulls. Mm. You know, some pastures, they'll run bulls for 5 years, but I don't think all the bulls make 5 years. We keep about a dozen bulls around, but, you know, and we'll turn out maybe three bulls with 100 cows. And, you know, you got them there all year, for 49 weeks out of the year, whatever it is, you got them standing there, you turn them out, and 10 days later, they're lame.
Right.
Yeah. You know, so it's kind of a crapshoot. But then the other side, you know, we talk, but I don't tolerate wild bulls.
Right.
And I don't, the first day a bull doesn't want to turn around and leave when I want to chase him, he ever drops his head to shake him. Well, he's on the next trip to town.
Ernie talks about some of the wisdom he acquired from an old cattle buyer when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Winter of 2025. Will you be freezing from head to toe with icicles coming from your nose? Or would you rather be on a 16-day journey with the Spirit of the West cruise? Our group flies to Fort Lauderdale on February 3rd and will enjoy a 14-day Circle of Caribbean cruise. Enjoy the warm sunshine, turquoise waters, and the camaraderie of folks you have so much in common with. The ship is the Majestic Princess, and you'll visit 8 of the Caribbean's most beautiful ports of call. Airfare is included, and if you book before May the 1st, 2024, you'll get a generous discount. No chores, no cooking, cleaning, or shoveling ice out of the water trough. And for all the details, see our cruise page at hugh-mcclennan.com and call 1-800-530-0131. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. Red Steagall is on the playlist this week, and you'll hear one of his good ones right after Ernie Isrealson has more savvy insights for ranchers and cattlemen.
An old boy that knew a whole lot about cattle way back in the 60s used to buy my calves for me, and he'd buy my little, 350-pound red and white Hereford calves, and that's what I started out feeding.
Right.
And he said, Ernie, you want to buy a calf with loose hide and hair. He said, that calf will always grow into that hide. And he's right. You take a tight-skinned, short-haired animal, and that animal never makes the first sort of when you're shipping fats.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Heard guys say that they went away from Herefords because the buyers were not paying quite as much because their hides were thicker and tougher. So loss of weight, more weight in the hide.
No, I've never experienced that myself. And the herps aren't anywhere near as popular. Well, one of the reasons with horned herps, and even though in BC the horned herps still play a part on the range,
Yeah.
And they have, but back our way, where the cattle are kept close to home, we don't need them to be, predator. Yeah. And the exotics have all become polled.
Right.
When they came over here, they all had horns.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the exotics, marbled better, like the Belgian Blue and the Charolais, were double muscle cattle. They're very lean cattle. The meat was lean. And back in the 80s, lean was in.
Yeah. I thought it was really interesting in Buenos Aires and Uruguay, they're using the Angus and Angus crosses.
Yes.
But when you go to Costa Rica, they're using a Charolais Brahma cross.
Yes, that's right.
I would have thought that. I would have expected that more here.
Yeah, even though Costa Rica must be a little bit warmer, maybe. And the reason they put the Brahma in them is because they're loose skinned and they can flick any part of their hide that they want to get the flies off.
Oh, they flick like a horse does.
Yeah, very much so. Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, And like the King Ranch had the Santa Catrina's cattle. They had some Brahma in them. And they end up being red.
Right.
And of course they were bred up for southern Texas, which is not far away from Costa Rica.
Yeah, right.
And actually they were good looking cattle.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But they did
they
have
were
a little,
interesting looking.
Yeah, they had a little extra ear to them. You could kind of see what they were, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And for him, and the longer, straighter nose.
Yeah, and I think the reason he might have chose Charolais, and like the Charolais are good cattle, was just because the colors matched. The Brahmas tend to be a grayish type of animal, and all of his cattle were.
My memories go back to the days of a team of good old draft horses pulling the buck rake as we stacked loose hay, and Ernie has some real insights comparing costs from those days to these days of $600,000 tractors after some cowboy pride from Red Steagall.
It's been hot and dry since the 1st of July, summer rain skipped us this time. Oh, there ain't much to say, just turns out that way. We live west of the dry line. If I told you I didn't worry about the weather and such, you just might call me a liar. But I trust in the Lord. He's been good to me. That's my boy dragging calves to the fire. That's my boy dragging calves to the fire. There's markets and interest, cool and mad cow. Trade embargoes are getting me down. Granddaddy fought the Comanche, then lost out to Nestor's pushing a plow. At the bank there's a note standing between me and broke. Great interest, only two above prime. Takes all we can do just to get through and make another payment on time. If I told you I didn't worry about making ends meet, you just might call me a liar. But I trust in the Lord. He's been good to me. That's my boy dragging calves to the fire. That's my boy dragging calves to the fire.
There's a pretty little redhead running the meat. She helps her mom keep the books. They're the rest of my crew, and whenever they're through, they'll throw on the feed. They're the cooks. Never thought I'd reach 50 quite as quick as I have. Wonder where my youth was spent. Chasing big dreams, scheming big schemes. Reckon that's where it all went. If I told you I didn't worry about leaving too quick, you just might call me a liar. But I trust in the Lord, He's been good to me. That's my boy dragging calves to the fire. That's my boy dragging calves to the fire. Yeah, that's my boy dragging calves to the fire.
I think it's that way in a lot of places. Yeah, your kids will come home at branding time as long as you'll let them rope. Well, after hearing the interview that Mark and Kathy recorded on the cruise ship with Ernie Isrealson, I was just thinking that would have made a great session for the entire cruise gang to hear. And here's more.
Yeah, we want to touch on a little different subject, you know, just how farming has evolved over the years. For when maybe my granddad in the 30s had 2, 4, or 6 horsepower on the implement, eh?
Yeah.
And how they maybe had to work the soil 5 or 6 times to get it fit to seed.
Yeah.
And of course they dried it out, and when the 30s came along, it blew away.
Right.
To where my dad farmed, and he had 2 35 horsepower tractors. One we still have, a John Deere A.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And when I started farming, you know, I went to 100 horsepower tractor, kind of like the John Deere 4020s when I started, eh? And now we got 500-600 horsepower four-wheel drives, but and we only have to make one pass, you know, zero till, so we don't have to disturb the soil. So you don't see any dust bowls in the spring anymore.
Right.
And the method of farming where we can do zero till, and the package of herbicides and insecticides or whatever else you want to call it that we have to use, if we use them correctly and smartly, are very good, eh? And that includes Roundup. You know, it's a tool. People think it sterilizes the soil. Well, you could spray your garden and kill the weeds one day and plant your beans the next day.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We got good tools available, eh? And during that time, we've taken from maybe when my grandfather would have grown, 30 bushel wheat crop, and maybe on summer fall, eh? To where my dad would have grown a 45 bushel wheat crop, to when I started, 60 bushel wheat crop was kind of the norm.
Right.
To now, when my boys are farming, if you don't grow 100 bushel crop in our area, you almost got a crop failure.
Mm.
You know, it's that expected. Mm-hmm. And
that's on the same acreage.
On the same acreage, yeah. Yes. And so we've increased our production at least threefold from back in the 30s.
And what about the quality of the wheat now versus the quality of, what they were putting out back then?
I think it's a better quality.
Yeah.
Genetics.
Genetics are better. The uniformity is better.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the plant is better. It ripens more uniformly, so you can harvest it more uniformly. And the machines we have to harvest it don't damage the kernels as much,
right.
Eh? So there have been vast improvements that maybe our general public doesn't always recognize or appreciate.
Coming up, there is more from Ernie Isrealson and more good music. And the Rangeland News when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. Back when I was young, I can remember seeing big straw piles actually being burned after the thrashing machine augured the grain into the granary and the straw got blown into a big pile. Oh, I really loved those days of pitching bundles onto the conveyor, and that sure got a guy in shape. And we thought we were doing things right, but as Ernie Isrealson says, we really weren't.
In the 70s, I rented the neighbor's place, and the hills had blown off, so there wasn't any fiber or soil up there that grew much, eh? And we'd cut the straw and we'd leave it there and we'd work it in, eh? Because you got to realize back in the 30s what they did. when they had the binders at Stukes.
Yeah. Right.
They took all that fiber off the field and blew it into a pile. And if they needed it for cattle or pigs, fine, but if not, they burned it. Huh? So that fiber would never went back into the soil. Right. And finally, that soil got depleted from fiber. Mm-hmm. Where now, you know, we have the amount, with the power, and because we have our combines that could cut the straw up and blow it out and spread it out, it's manageable. Mm-hmm. And we can reincorporate that in the soil. And we're increasing the fiber content of our soil, which in turn allows for more water filtration into that soil.
Right.
And as far as fertilizer and stuff, you know, we're really not removing or putting in any more nutrients than what we're taking out. Mm-hmm. You know, we go from growing 30 bushels of wheat to growing 100 bushels of wheat. That 100 bushels of wheat has to take more nutrients out of the soil than that 30 bushels ever did.
Yeah,
so you have to keep it balanced, eh? Mm-hmm. But I'm not I'm against excesses in anything, and it is a fine line to be balanced, eh?
Mm-hmm.
But it's there. We got some very good people out there looking after the soil, and we got some very good ranchers also. You know, I always refer to myself in agriculture, because if I had one pet peeve when I started farming, was the old boy they always had a picture of with a straw hat and chewing on a blade of brome, and we all know it, eh?
Yeah.
And my contention today is, if you can be successful in farming or agriculture, you can be successful in any other career you might have chose to be in.
The way the Canada Revenue Agency deals with ranchers and farmers has changed a lot in the last few years. And the financial decisions we make today can have a long-lasting impact on our bottom line far into the future. It really helps to have a trusted professional who really understands your situation to guide you with all your accounting requirements and your tax preparation. Having an accountant who knows the difference between a Hereford and a heifer, what a slick and backgrounding are, and that alfalfa and Timothy are not just names from a storybook really helps. Kathy McMillan of PMT Chartered Professional Accountants understands the intricacies of specialized programs like AgriStability and AgriInvest. She understands the demands on your time and can help you spend more time doing your job and less time dealing with endless piles of paperwork. See PMTAccountants.com or call toll-free 877-383-8081. Now, just ahead of the Rangeland news, here's another look back in the past from Abe Zacharias.
As I walk around the old home place, my thoughts drift back in time and space. Old memories seem to cloud my tear-dimmed eyes. I remember Grandpa telling me, when I die, just bury me beneath that old oak tree beyond the rise. Back when I was barely four, I'd wear the spurs that Grandpa wore. He promised me that someday they'd be mine. I can still see Grandpa grinning when I got those rowels spinning. Oh, I wish that it could happen one more time. Now Grandpa's spurs don't jingle anymore. I can still see them hanging on the ranch house door. As I stroke the faded leather, cracked and dried up from the weather, I know Grandpa's spurs don't jingle anymore. Those spurs have traveled everywhere, from roundups to the county fair, and raked the hides of broncs at the rodeo. They've been down some dusty trails through mud and sleet, snow and hail, and worn where tough old cowboys had to go. Grandpa hung them on the door when he couldn't cowboy anymore. He knew that I'd be coming back someday. Those spurs mean everything to me. They're part of Grandpa's legacy, and I treasure them much more than words can say. Now Grandpa's spurs don't jingle anymore.
I can still see them hanging on the ranch house door. As I stroke the faded leather, cracked and dried out from the weather, I know Grandpa's spurs don't jingle anymore. I stroke the faded leather, cracked and dried out from the weather, I know Grandpa's spurs don't jingle anymore.
The Rangeland News from the Spirit of the West. A roundup of issues and events from the world of agriculture.
At the top of page one, it says, sticker shock at the grocery store. Seems like it's never going to end, and it might not, but it might be easing up a bit. And again, Gary Crawford has the story.
In 2022, grocery store food prices went up a lot, by about 11.5%. Last year saw prices go up by a still historically large 5%. However, food shoppers could get a break this year. The Agriculture Department's new forecast for this year is for a food price hike of only 1.2%.
That would be the lowest percent change since 2019.
USDA economist Megan Schweitzer had been forecasting a 1.6% food price hike, but during March, food prices did not go up at all.
And so that is part of what's contributing to our annual forecast being adjusted down.
That, plus low inflation rates for other things that affect food prices, things like energy. And also, of course,
prices for unprocessed agricultural commodities have just begun increasing again, but they had declined for a year and a half before that. And they're still down about 20%.
Down 20% from their peak 2 years ago. Gary Crawford for the U.S. Department of Agriculture.
The FDA recently revealed that bird flu has been detected in about 5 milk samples collected from grocery stores, highlighting an ongoing issue within the dairy sector. And this discovery is part of a large study aimed at understanding the spread of highly pathogenic avian influenza across dairy herds, now confirmed in 9 states, including a newly reported case in Colorado. And despite the presence of the virus in milk samples, the FDA emphasizes that all dairy products remain safe for public consumption. This confidence stems from findings that demonstrate the effectiveness of pasteurization in killing the virus. No bird flu was detected in tests of retail powdered infant formula, further supporting the safety of dairy products under current processing standards. The Canadian and Manitoba governments have announced a significant investment in Manitoba's livestock predation program. This collaboration aims to fortify farms against wildlife threats by funding proactive measures that deter predator attacks on livestock. And the program's part of a broader sustainable Canadian agricultural partnership, under which both governments will provide $500,000 to support Manitoba farmers. The funding will allow for the purchase of essential equipment and the construction of predator-resistant fencing, ensuring that farmers can continue their operations without the looming threat of predator attacks. And the program offers 2 funding streams. One stream allows for the purchase of predation prevention equipment and guardian dogs, while the other supports the construction of specialized fencing to protect calving and lambing areas, pastures, and other sensitive sites. And eligible producers, particularly those with previous predation claims, can receive up to 75% cost coverage for the protective measures. A technology has been developed to quickly convert livestock manure, a significant issue in animal farming, into valuable black gold rich in carbon in 1 day. Dr. Yuji Ho and his research team from the Clean Air Research Lab of the Korea Institute of Energy Research has developed a process that immediately converts livestock manure into biochar at livestock farms. Using the process developed by the research team, it's possible to convert 10 tons of livestock manure into biochar in a single day. And as of 2022, the amount of livestock manure produced was about 50 million tons, of which 87% is used as a compost and liquid fertilizer after being fermented over a long period. An agreement to protect a sprawling ranch in southern Alberta from development is the largest of its kind in the country, the Nature Conservancy of Canada says, and will allow the family that owns it to continue raising cattle there. The 22,000-hectare McIntyre Ranch was founded south of Lethbridge in 1894 by William McIntyre, and it remained in his family until his son Billy died in 1947. and a longtime family friend and employee, Ralph Thrall, bought the property after Billy's death, and the Thrall family continues to own and operate it today. We have just maintained the legacy of sustainable ranching, and the McIntyre began when they came up from Texas and saw the overgrazing that had occurred through the Midwest. And so they learned through others' mistakes and left the grass rather than taking it all. The words of Ralph Thrall. And in return, Thrall says his family continues to own the property while getting a financial boost for their ranching business. Yeah, that's a great operation. I've talked to some of the guys that have ridden on that iconic place, and it is really something. Well, you can mark your calendars for July the 19th to the 21st. There will be a gathering of great cowboy entertainers at the Vilna Cowboy Fest Vilna Cultural Center. And you can get all the information at vilnaagsociety.com. One of Canada's finest fiddle players, Alfie Meyer and Byron, will be there, along with folks like Old Ugly and Doris Daly and Doc Mail and many more. And then September the 13th to 15th is the Caroline Cowboy Music and Poetry Festival. Oh boy, what a lineup there. Last week I mentioned that Ed Brown was going to be there, but Ed is probably busy with spring turnout in Manitoba, so he won't be, but get this, B.J. Smith, Ben Crane, Ed and Gail Peekakoot, Doris Daly, Doc Mail, the Traveling Mabels, Eli Barzee, Tom Cole, Matt Robertson, Mel Brown, and several more. And you can get the information by emailing anothercarolinegathering@gmail.com. Well, June the 4th, there's a regular cattle sale at the Kamloops Yards of the BC Livestock Co-op, and then another sale on June the 18th. And you can watch all their sales streaming live at bclivestock.bc.ca. And meanwhile, at the Innisfail Auction Market, lots of good cattle coming through, and Cattle of all classes, of course, sell every Wednesday. Get all the information at InnisfailAuctionMarket.com, or just pick up the phone and call Dwayne, Mark, or Danny at 1-800-710-3166. Okay, and now it's the final item. And we were actually working on our gutters the other day, and we found out that the space between the rungs on the ladders are bigger than they were a couple of generations ago. And I was wondering why, so I asked the guy at the hardware store, and he said, that is because, in general, people are getting taller. And so I guess I'd call that climate change. Okay, and that's the Rangeland News. There is a danger lurking out in those lush green pastures, and it can take its toll on horses. We've been through it, and I will look into laminitis and founder on the Irvine Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. You know, a lot of horses have been affected sometimes for life by a condition that I'll talk about on the Irvine Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File coming right up. But first, winter of 2025. Will you be freezing from head to toe with icicles coming from your nose? Or would you rather be on a 16-day journey with the Spirit of the West Cruise? Our group flies to Fort Lauderdale on February 3rd and will enjoy a 14-day Circle of Caribbean cruise. Enjoy the warm sunshine, turquoise waters, and the camaraderie of folks you have so much in common with. The ship is the Majestic Princess, and you'll visit 8 of the Caribbean's most beautiful ports of call. Airfare is included. No chores, no cooking, cleaning, or shoveling ice out of the water trough. And for all the details, see our cruise page at hugh-mcclennan.com and call 1-800-530-0131.
Now it's time for the Horse Training File, brought to you by Irvine Tack and Western Wear, Canada's largest Western store.
This spring, they're bursting at the seams at Irvine Tack and Western Wear.
New items, new seasons. Saddle up for Urbans and check out the latest arrivals from the top brand names. Jackets, shirts, jeans, boots, accessories, a long list of Western wear with a welcome twist. Something for cowboys, cowgirls, and city folks, too. So suit up for spring with over 130,000 square feet of selection. Exit 305 off Highway 2 by Crossfield. Shop online at urbans.ca.
The world's greatest Western store.
As that grass in the pasture gets greener and more lush, there's one important factor to consider before you let your horses out 24/7. Laminitis is a condition that affects horses' hooves, and with this condition, there's inflammation of the laminae, that part of the hoof that connects the inside of the hoof wall to the coffin bone inside the hoof. And it's a painful condition. It can cause severe lameness in the affected foot. It can be so severe that veterinarians even need to recommend euthanasia sometimes if it progresses far enough. The good news is if it's caught early, it can often be overcome. I know with both Lucky and Becca and Lucky and Cody, two of our good ranch mares, they have both foundered, Lucky on grass and Cody actually on lush hay. And thankfully, because of good care from our farriers, they're both fine now, but we have to be careful. Now, some of the symptoms to watch for are, of course, lameness in one or the other, most often in a front foot. And another real indicator is the horse standing with his front feet extended, not wanting to put them flat down on the ground. And the other thing that people sometimes wonder about is founder. And for a while, I always thought founder and laminitis were the same thing. But they're not. When laminitis refers to the inflammation of the laminae between the coffin bone and the hoof wall, founder is a sinking or rotation of the coffin bone in the hoof capsule. That's what happens after they've had laminitis for a while, and this damage is often caused by laminitis. And I've actually been able to pick up a front foot and feel the sole of the hoof, and in an advanced stage, feel the front of the coffin bone pushing down on the inside of the sole of the hoof. So the big thing is to be careful on what you're feeding them, and if you're turning them out on green grass in the spring, the idea is only turn them out for a short time until their system kind of gets used to all that sugar, and watch them carefully, and if they show any signs of laminitis or founder, get them on to dry feed as soon as possible. And for Irvine Saddles and Western Wear, that's the horse training file. And again, that's what we really like about feeding our horses a daily feeding of Hoffman's Horse Ration, because not like grain with a lot of sugar in it, Hoffman's Horse Ration is very safe for horses of all kinds. And you can find out what's in it and how it works and why it works at hoffmanshorseproducts.com. I got quite a few comments about a song I played last week from Bob Marshall. It was called The Old Horse Barn, and a lot of you said you really liked it, but you wanted to know a little more about who Bob Marshall is. Well, he rodeoed for over 20 years, and he's been a musician for that same time as well. He's raised and trained a lot of horses and still runs a training facility, although him and that great band seems they're spending more and more time on the road. So here's another one from the Bob Marshall Band called Cowboy Blessing.
My father was a saddle tramp, my mother was a saint. She put up with his cowboy ways, never voiced complaint. One day my father left the ranch to strike out on his own. She hung a homemade sign above the doorway to our home. May you better never grumble, your heart never ache. Your horse never stumble and your cinch never break. May your life be filled with laughter in good times and despair. May God see you in heaven, for the devil knows you're there. Once I had a pretty wife, a home to hang my spurs. I thought I'd best quit my roaming cowboy days for her. She saw it broke my heart, left my soul half dead. Loving me, she set me free, and this is what she said. May you better never grumble, your heart never ache. Your horse cross, never stumble, and your cinch never break. May your life be filled with laughter in good times and despair. May God see you in heaven, for the devil knows you're there. Saddles and many miles rode. I'm older but no wiser for those wild seeds I've sowed. But when I reach that final gate to heaven's grazing lands, I hope to hear St. Peter's voice giving this command. May your bed never grumble, your heart never ache, your horse never stumble, and your cinch never break. May your life be filled with laughter in good times and despair. May God see you in heaven, for the devil knows you're there. May God see you in heaven, for the devil knows you're there.
You can forget all about combing and searching all over the place to locate tractor parts. Check out the most convenient place to find parts for any make, bztractorparts.com. Massey Ferguson, Ford, John Deere, David Brown, Case, International Harvester, Universal, Deutz, Lightland, Landini, Oliver Flat, Ali, Zetor, White, and so many more. Just call 250-395-0960. Email bztractorparts56@gmail.com.
Well, I think it's time we got you back to that cruise ship where Mark and Kathy were having this fascinating visit with Ernie Isrealson.
Yeah, I know they, you know, they farm more acres. They burn more fuel.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when I bought my first 4020, I paid $10,000 for it.
Yeah.
You go look at a new tractor now, and they're $600,000, $700,000. Mm-hmm. Combine's $1 million.
Yeah.
And every year, even when I started, you know, they said you couldn't make a living in farming, and I was able to prove that wrong. But today, I'm looking at these high-priced pieces of equipment at $1 million, and I'm saying, I don't know if we can do it.
The interest alone.
Yes. Even in the calf business, you know, and I pointed it out to Trister last fall when we're, because he put in a pit of, build a couple of extra pens, and he wanted to feed more calves, and so he's got more cattle around. He's doing a little custom feeding also. But, you know, these calves we're buying were cost us $2,000 a head, where the first calves old Tony Hammer bought me, I referred to, I think they were 30 cents a pound. So some of those calves were under $100 a head.
Yeah.
You know? So there's been quite a spread in that too. But today it's 7% interest on a $2,000 calf. We're going to pay over $140 a head interest on those cattle,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
Just in the time frame we have them. And that is going to be a big factor. Mm-hmm. So are the calves too high, or is the interest too high?
You know,
some things are a little bit out of balance right now.
We've
backed up our calving a little bit. We used to start about the 15th of March, but the equinox always have a shock. You know, there seems to be a stormy period in there and a cold period.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And I've hauled enough calves to the barn to warm them up.
Yeah.
So we're on the other side of the equinox now. We're more like the first part of April.
Right.
And, you know, just, and calf lost. Christopher has a friend, big ranch, southeastern Alberta, and they, I guess, I will say they calve 800 head, and they break them up into 200 head herds and put them on a couple sections of land, and they don't check them.
Uh-huh.
And come Brandon time, and Christopher went down to Brandon, helping Brand, they only had 8 open cows out of those 200 head that didn't have a calf on them. Do the work here, so.
Yeah.
I should get out of here and leave you guys.
Okay, Ernie, just pronounce your last name for us here. Before.
Isrealson.
Isrealson.
Just like the country.
Yep.
Israel.
Okay, that's just so Hugh doesn't call you something else on the show.
Yeah, thanks for doing that, Mark. It can happen. And still to come is a classic Song of the West and the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. Kyle Evans spent more than 20 years in the music industry as an entertainer and recording artist, and he recorded in Nashville, and he produced and composed a lot of his own albums and had his own publishing company, and he headlined cowboy poetry gatherings everywhere at the time he was at his peak. Sadly, he passed away on July the 5th, 2001, from the injuries he suffered after his motorcycle collided with a deer. And I sure like his version of this old favorite written by Smiley Burnett and Gene Autry. And that's another interesting story for another day.
When evening chores are over at our ranch house on the plains, and all I got to do is sit around, I saddle my old pony and ride on down the trail and walk. Desert sun go down, riding down the canyon, watch the sun go down, a picture that no artist ever paints, white face cattle lowing on the mountainside, I hear a coyote whining for its mate, cactus plants are blooming, sagebrush everywhere, granite spires are standing all around. I tell you folks, it's heaven to be riding down the trail when the desert sun goes down. Cactus are blooming, sagebrush everywhere, granite spires are standing all around. I tell you folks, it's heaven to be riding down the trail when the desert goes down.
The famous XIT Ranch is one of those legendary outfits. It opened up in the Texas Panhandle and operated from about 1893, I think, until about 1912. Originally, it was over 3 million acres and ran for 200 miles along the border with New Mexico, varying in width from 20 to 30 miles, and it stretched throughout 10 counties in Texas, and at its peak, handled about 150,000 head of cattle. And that brand, the XIT, was chosen for its difficulty to alter, and that maybe discouraged a few folks from trying to rustle those calves and change the brand. And now, here's Chad Sullivan in the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight with the XIT Cowboy.
I have always been impressed with how the early cowboys survived the elements of the Old West, and after reading a journal kept by a cowboy who worked the ranges of the famed XIT ranch in West Texas, I was moved to write this poem. There was once a spread of land back in the early years that was home to the cowboy man when the cowboy had no fear. It was miles wide and would test a cowboy's strength, and it took a horse with stride to cover the whole damn length. Now there were many acres, 3 million to be exact, covered with mesquite, brush and grass, and even the yucca plant. Now life as a cowboy here was very, very tough, surviving the elements from year to year in a land that was wild and woolly and rough. And the work was hard and long. It put the cowboy to the test, but it made him awful strong and always brought out his best. He was taught the cowboy way, to be honest and earn his keep, to help a neighbor find a stray, to give a hand when the mud was deep. It taught him how to love nature and the beast, to put the land, the cow, the horse above, and himself, last and least. You see, the cowboy couldn't win, even if he tried, against the rain, ice, fires, dust, and wind, and the snow that seemingly would blind. So he learned to respect the land and treat it in God's ways, always lend a hand, for the future, for better days. This spread was big and rough, but for it the cowboy'd stand, because it gave him life, and it gave him love, this ranch with the XIT brand.
Thanks again for making the ride, and I sure hope you can join us right here next week at the same time. And as always, thanks to Mark and Kathy McMillan, our great support crew. Now be sure to check the latest issue of Canadian Cowboy Country Magazine for all kinds of great reading and pictures, and you can subscribe online at CanadianCowboy.ca. Be sure to check out our YouTube channel for this show and many more from the past with video and lots of videos of the Western Spirit Band and ranching scenes and much more. The links are on our website, Hugh-McLennan.com. Till next week, I'm Hugh McLennan. Hope to see you down the trail somewhere real soon.